Wrestling and WrestleMania. All right, we're back here live, and I'm going to turn to my right and ask if you'd introduce yourself right there.
My name is Brad Rheingans. I'm a former Olympian and former Olympic coach, and I did wrestle professionally, and I still am.
Now, you say you were an Olympian. When was that?
1976 in Montreal, 1980, which was the boycott. Mm-hmm. I was supposed to go to Moscow.
And you were an Olympic wrestler, and I see you're wearing tonight, those are the Olympic rings, and it's kind of timely, isn't it? Because we're seeing those Olympic rings right now. How did you do in the Olympics?
I was fourth in Montreal, and I was slated favorite for the 1980 Olympic Games. I was a bronze medalist in the 1979 World Championships. And, of course, in the boycott, came around.
That's 1980 when we boycotted the Olympics in 1980. We didn't go.
Yeah, I just couldn't commit another 4 years to the Olympics. The times were pretty tough up to that point anyway. I was tired of living in attics and, you know, catching a meal here and there and begging for money to train, because if anybody that's in tune with the Olympics knows that it's tough to be an Olympic competitor in this country and make a living, especially if you have a family.
Yeah, that's a tough grind. Brad, we're going to have a look. We have a tape there, and I'm going to ask our director out there, if we can, we're going to put a tape on you in action. Now, this is Greco-Roman wrestling. Am I correct in that, Brad?
Yes.
Now, here you are. Which one are you, Brad?
I'm the short one.
The short one. Red or black?
I'm in the blue, and the Russian is in the red. Mm-hmm. Seven-time world champion, two-time Olympic champion.
He was, huh?
Yeah.
Who won this match?
The Russian.
Looks like you.
He was the only one I couldn't, the only competitor in the world championships that I couldn't beat at that time.
Now, what we saw here, and you've also done pro wrestling, haven't
you? Yes, I have.
What we saw here, this clip, it looks an awful lot different from what we saw Billy Jack doing here. And I'm going to put this and just throw it out here to the people here. We've talked about the popularity of pro wrestling. We've talked about good versus evil. We've talked about an athletic event. What is it? What is pro wrestling? Right there, you want to identify yourself?
Yeah, my name is Terry Shanley. I'm also a former U.S. team member. Interestingly enough, Brad and I trained together back in the late 70s. I'm amongst the unpopular minority here. I'm not in favor of professional wrestling.
Why not?
Well, I don't discount the fact that it is entertainment. I don't discount the fact that they are incredible athletes. A lot of them are very, very talented athletes. The objection that I have is that they call it wrestling. It detracts from the amateur sport. It illegitimizes the amateur sport. There have been several athletes in high school that are very, very talented athletes that were not allowed to participate in wrestling because their parents were afraid that they'd be thrown out of a ring or hit with a fold-up metal chair. I don't believe that professional wrestling is real in terms of what happens in the ring. A couple of examples that come to mind is when a 265-pound man jumps from 4 feet in the air and lands on another man's neck, and that man isn't dead, somebody's faking. Because there's a friend of mine that I wrestled with at the University of Oregon that got hit by an elbow in the larynx, and it wasn't a very hard shot. And this guy is in tremendous physical condition. He speaks with a raspy voice to this day because one side of his vocal cord canal is dead. And he came about 30 seconds from actually dying if it weren't for a tracheotomy performed right there on the wrestling mat.
He must have been in bad shape.
Mm-hmm. I expected that kind of a comment, but physiologically, there's no way for a man to build up the musculature around a guy's neck to protect the larynx. None. He was in incredible shape.
I'm going to take you back to one of your statements there, Terry. You said it illegitimizes other wrestling. How does it do that in your view?
Well, I'm not discounting the popularity of the sport, because it's incredibly popular, and I think a lot of the popularity, personally, I'm not a psychologist, stems from the same reason people go to hockey games and want to watch a fight break out. Okay, the amateur sport is not the same as the professional sport, and this is the only arena I've ever seen that the professional sport is not an extension of the amateur sport. Golf, basketball, baseball, football, you name it, the pros do exactly the same as the amateurs have done. You've just seen a tape where they are not doing exactly as professionals or amateurs are doing.
You don't want to identify yourself, please?
Marlon Braun, Portland State wrestling coach, head wrestling coach.
I'd like to hear your views on that. You're here also from the amateur wrestling community, a prominent member. What do you think?
Well, Terry and I talked about it some. You know, we didn't know each other were going to be here, but
You know, my beliefs are that it's not real wrestling. You know, my belief also is that it's not, you know, I don't want to say that it's not entertainment. Very many people from, like they say, everybody, all walks of life are entertained by it. My biggest complaint is that they do compare it to real wrestling, mm-hmm. which I consider amateur wrestling. Now, they can call their wrestling real for them, but that's theirs. And I guess in some way I would like to know that there's a difference. And one thing that I've always wondered about, and I've talked to other people, and everybody asks me, well, what makes you think that it's not real? And maybe I'm wrong, but I would like to know if what's amateur sports or professional sports aren't bet on professionally by gamblers.
What's your point on that?
Well, I would like to know, is professional wrestling, do they have a line in Vegas? You know, is there a line? I've never known that a bookie would take a bet on professional wrestling.
Terry, I'm going to ask you again. When you say it isn't real, what we're seeing out here are these, you're saying, is pulled punches?
Yes.
And
the reason I say that is a couple of examples come to mind. Boxers, they wear 8-ounce padded gloves. And at the end of a match, their faces are all swollen and puffy. These guys are coming out with bare fists hitting each other, and they don't swell up. That doesn't make sense to me. Another thing is, if you want to inflict as much punishment on your opponent as you can, you're going to do that from a position of power, with both feet firmly planted on the mat or on the ground or whatever. If you watch real closely, whenever they hit somebody, they raise a foot and stamp the mat at the same time they hit them, whether it's an uppercut or down, and you watch it closely, and
that's true.
All right.
Tony Borne, you've got the microphone.
You're making me hot. Professional wrestling is a continuation of amateur wrestling. I'll tell you, I was an amateur wrestler. My son was an amateur wrestler. I was a professional wrestler for 29 years. My son, wait a minute, shut up, I'm talking. My son has been a professional now for 8 years. He's a great wrestler, he's a great amateur, and he's going to be a great professional, I really believe so. But I consider it an insult to my profession, because there is nothing phony about me, nothing at all.
Well, nobody's saying, he's not saying that anything is phony about you. What he's saying is basically that it's a drama, that it's acting, that the punches are pulled. Mean Mike, you're not, how do you feel about that, Mean Mike?
Well, when I get out of that ring, I give 120% on anything I do.
Hey, I went home with lumps on my face where I couldn't talk. I've right. been where I couldn't talk for 6 weeks, too. And that hurts me when I can't talk.
Dislocated shoulder, dislocated broken ankles, plate and 7 screws in my ankle.
You know, we've got a clip here of Billy Jack in action where things didn't go so well. Let's, if we could, producers, let's please run that clip of Billy Jack when things didn't go too well. I think you know the one I mean.
Get some help in there. Busted him wide open, Jess.
He did.
You know, the referee's got to verbally warn these guys. You can't take it physically upon yourself. You got to warn him with those heavy fines. Oh, right between the eyes. Well, oh, look at the blood just spewing out of the forehead. Billy Jack Haynes.
You know what they call that, Gorilla? That's called winning the battle.
Billy Jack. Back to you. There you were in action, and there's blood, and you've heard it said that this isn't real. Go ahead.
Okay, this first, I'm not here to put anybody down whatsoever. I mean, these people have their right to their opinion. That's why we live in the United States of America.
You bet.
Okay, and I respect you as amateurs very, very much. As a professional level, I have to extremely disagree with you. I've been in this business for 6 years. I've had over $12,000 worth of medical bills. Pardon this. I've had my teeth knocked out. I've had my nose broke 4 times. I've had 190 stitches in my head. I've had 80 stitches in the back of my head. I've had my ankle broke twice. I've had my knee operated on twice. I've had my elbow operated on twice. I've had staph infection from having to wrestle every night, not just once, whatever. And I think what the whole problem boils down to is that every time there's an amateur match in the Coliseum, you draw 2,000 and we draw 12,000. I think you're jealous of that fact.
Right there, man. Let's take it to the fans. First, let me ask this of the fans here. Going back to the, I suppose we could get in trouble over what real means, but let's just throw it out to you. How many people think it's real? Fans. How many think it's real? How many fans don't think it's real? There's lots of people who are fans who don't think it's real, right there. Do you want to go back again, Terry?